Good morning. My name is Jim Birchfield, senior pastor here at First Presbyterian Church, Houston, and it's my great pleasure to be the first to welcome you to our worship service today. Before we begin our broadcast, I'd like to share a few things that we hope will improve your worship experience. First, we would love to know that you are here and if there are any ways that we can serve you. During today's service, our online pastor will join you in worship and be available to respond to any messages or questions that you might want to share online. If you're joining us on Facebook, please take a moment to like the service or to say hello. If you feel there is someone who might benefit from today's message, we encourage you to share it. If you're joining us from our website, you can complete a connection card, view today's bulletin, or share a need via our live prayer button. Finally, if you're a member of the FPC community or just want to contribute to the ongoing ministry initiatives of our church, you can give online or via text by clicking our Give Online button. Friends, I understand that this is a time when we may still seem far apart from one another. Please know that in this season, you are not alone. We are reminded that Christ is with us, that Christ is for us, and that Christ loves us. Remember that He promises us His peace, a peace we can own, and a peace that transcends all understanding. Your FPC family is with you and remains here to serve you. Please enjoy our service.
Good morning, and welcome to worship at First Presbyterian Church, Houston. We're so very glad that you chose to join us this morning, and we have all been praying that you would have an encounter with Jesus Christ, the risen Lord, today. My name is Jim Birchfield, and I'm here with Abigail McDougall, who is our new pastor to our young adult community, and she is going to open us in worship this morning.
Yes, good morning, church. We are grateful that you have joined us, and we believe that our God in His sovereignty has a specific word for you this morning. Though we are physically distant, we know that we worship a God who is near to us. So whether you come burdened, joyful, or grieving being far from others, know that He is near to us. So here, as we enter into worship from the unchanging word of God in these changing times, from Psalm 103. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The steadfast love of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting on those who fear him, to those who keep his covenant. Bless the Lord. Will you pray with me as we begin worship? Faithful God, we do bless you that no matter how far we run after other idols or how strongly we rebel against your good ways, you always keep your covenant. You are always calling to our hearts, beckoning us to find true life in relationship with you. So, merciful Father, may our worship today draw us back to your loyal love and back to you, Jesus, the compassionate and gracious source of true life. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, please shape our prayers and praises to be sweet incense to you, and may you be lifted high above all fears, anxieties, and distractions. Through song and speech, let us each hear anew an invitation to your everlasting loyal love. Amen. Family and friends across the city and even the nation, with expectant hearts, may we worship together.
Thank you.
And so we invite all of you now to embrace the posture of the prophet Isaiah. If you remember, Isaiah was lifted up into heavenly realms and saw angels in the throne of God, and he said, "Woe is me, I am a man of unclean lips." And I invite you and I to say the same, that as we enter into this worship time together, that we would come to the notion that we are people of unclean lips, that we are sinners in need of grace. And so I invite you now, let's join it together as we pray a prayer of confession. Lord God, we're grateful that even in our time of confession, where we tell you that we're sorry, that we admit to you ways in which we have wronged you and others and even ourselves, that we come to this time of prayer with great confidence and even joy, knowing that you listen and that you're ready to forgive us. And so, Lord, we admit to you that we have failed and that we have erred and that we have fallen away from you. We recognize that so many times in Scripture, you call your people an adulterous people, where you, God, keep your promises and that we, your people, don't. And so I pray that you would remind us that you see all that we are and do, that you know the ways in which we have elevated other things above our relationship with you, where because of our actions, we have hurt others. And even as we pray, Lord, we're just reminded that you long for us to be in a right relationship with you. And often what is needed most is for us just to say we're sorry. So we tell you that we're sorry, God. And we invite you now, people of God, to just spend a few moments in your own words, confess your sins before the Lord, and to do so now with the great confidence and the great knowledge that God is indeed listening, that he cares, and that he loves us. So let's spend just a few moments in silent confession. Friends, hear the good news, that even though we break our promises before the Lord, he will keep his. The scriptures say time and time again that God, this loving God, his love extends throughout all generations. That love that he promises to give to you, he will give to you. And that we can hear these words again and again and again, that we would believe them and receive them, that in Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen. I want to also let you know that during our moment of community that we'll have in just a moment, we have a couple who are covenant partners who will now lead us in that time.
Hey everyone, this is the Hamptons, and in response to God's initiating grace to us in Jesus Christ, we just want to take a brief moment from our home to yours to give you the peace of Christ this morning.
So go ahead and hug somebody in your family or send a text to someone that you love, or you can even type something in the chat box.
And we also have two quick announcements. The first, as you would probably know by now, we are open for in-person worship on a limited capacity basis. And the second one we want to encourage you with is that if you haven't already, please join us for the conversation that we're having for our Growing in Times of Exile series. Go online for more information on both of those announcements, but just really want to make a plug that for the conversation that we're having as a church body around the new series.
And so we know that COVID has been challenging for everybody in different ways, and we just wanted to encourage everybody that we are all in this together and that God is our hope during this time, and we are really looking forward to seeing everybody in person soon. God bless.
Bye-bye.
We continue this morning in our series on the Ten Commandments. And our topic is going to be adultery. The Bible speaks very directly to the subject. Yet for us, it's both complex and highly personal. So before I read from Exodus and from Matthew this morning, I think it would be wise for us to pray. So Lord, as we gather around your word this morning, our prayer is that you would be the one that speaks, that you would hide me behind your cross, that whatever words I have prepared would actually become your words, that what I share would be shared with grace and sensitivity, and that what we would hear would be from you. So guide us and direct us, we pray, as we submit and gather around your word. In Jesus' name, amen. So two texts this morning. The first from the book of Exodus, chapter 20, verse 14, literally the commandment. This says, you shall not commit adultery. And then in Matthew chapter 5, verses 27 and 28, Jesus restates the commandment, but then adds a very interesting twist to things. He said, you have heard that it was said, do not commit adultery. But I tell you that anyone who looks at a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her in his heart. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So in 2017, the Institute for Family Studies published a survey wherein 16% of adults who took the survey admitted to cheating on their spouse. That broke out to be about 20% of men who responded and 13% of women who were willing to admit that at one point or another they had cheated on their spouse. Interestingly, among Christians who were surveyed as part of that study, those that attended worship one time or less in a year admitted to 19% saying that they had cheated on a spouse. And somewhat sadly, in my opinion, those who attended or at least reported attending worship on a weekly basis reported that 14% had cheated on a spouse. Now, we could cite that as further evidence of the collapse of our culture, but if we're honest and we're at all readers of history, we would know that there has been a historical failure of all people and the people of God to live up to this commandment. Even a cursory reading of the Bible confronts us with King David's adultery. An understanding of the New Testament reveals the adultery and the sexual sin that existed within the churches that Paul wrote his letters to. It doesn't take a deep reading of church history to know that through the entire life of the church, certainly up to the present day, there have been story after story after story of people who have seen their ministries collapse or seen their churches divide over the sin of adultery. So we could then say that it's fair to ask the question, why would God give such a command? Why would God give a command that was so hard for people to follow? And I suppose it might even be reasonable to say, how can such a command be relevant to our lives today? How could it actually be useful to us as we try to navigate life in the culture we find ourselves in now? I would suggest that maybe we can begin to find an answer to those questions by actually flipping the question. And instead of asking why would God give us such an unachievable commandment, what if we ask the question, why is fidelity in marriage, indeed, why is marriage at all so important to God? I think there's several reasons. Let me touch on a couple this morning. The first goes back to context. Again, remember that God is attempting to take a people who have been living in slavery for hundreds of years, and out of these people, he's attempting to create a new community. A community of people whose entire lives are built upon love for him and love for their neighbor, and then a desire to be a witness to the power and the love of God by the way they work together for the common good. And for that community to flourish, right, for that community to actually serve the common good and to actually be the kind of witness to the grace and the love of God that God wants them to be, wants us to be, that requires trust. In that community, just as in our community, I not only need to know that I care about the thriving of my marriage or the thriving of my family, but that you care enough about the thriving of my family to help me protect my marriage and help me protect my children as they grow to become all that God wants them to be. From a theological standpoint, we could say that the covenant of marriage was established by God to bring health to the larger community, that it's supposed to be reflective of God's covenant promise to us, that there is a relationship of mutual submission one to another, a relationship based upon grace, and again, I dare say, trust, that is to mirror the relationship that God has established with us. Thirdly, I hope you would agree that marriages and families that are healthy contribute to a healthy community. That it's in the interest of both adults, it's in the interest of any children, should they have them, to grow up in a home, grow up in a community that is characterized by love, that is characterized by security, that gives people the ability to grow in their faith. And again, that requires trust. So even here at the beginning of this sermon, we have to kind of return back to this essential question that we've been asking from the beginning of this series, which is, are we going to live for God, or are we going to live for ourselves? Are we going to work to see if we can't understand God's definition of what it means to live freely, to live towards God's definition of what abundant life looks like? Or are we going to insist on living according to our own terms? And that's, friends, I'm not trying to be, trying to exercise any rhetorical flourish by asking that question. It just seems to me to be the obvious question to ask. Because this fundamental choice we make between choosing to live into God's definition of what freedom and abundance looks like creates the lens then by which we view life. And if we're going to view life purely from our own desires, wants, and needs and definitions, then we're never going to understand why God would ask such a thing of us and those in our community. So that's a look at why I think God has established this command that reinforces fidelity in marriage and even kind of underscores the importance of marriage to the larger community in and of itself. Let's take a negative look at why God would forbid adultery. First of all, it breaks trust. Again, if trust is the essential thing that holds together a family, that holds together a marriage, and even holds together a community, the fundamental disaster of adultery is that it breaks that trust. It does tremendous damage to individuals and to families, and it even tears at the fabric of communities. I think we're all aware of churches who've literally seen splits take place because people have had to take sides in a marriage that is broken. One writer says that to commit the sin of adultery is to actually break multiple commands. It's breaking the command not to have idols as we replace God in our life with some other thing that we hold higher than God's vision for our life. It leads us into a life basically defined by bearing false witness as we build a web of lies around us to sustain this life that we have chosen. And of course, it's theft. It's stealing our neighbor's peace. Stealing our neighbor's ability to thrive and to flourish. I want to be direct about this as well as sensitive. It's an inherently selfish choice. It's saying either, not so much that I love you, what it's really saying is I love you enough, or I love myself enough to use you. It's not so much that I love you, it's that I really don't care what kind of havoc I create because, well, as the popular song says, the heart wants what the heart wants. It's, of course, a betrayal. It's a betrayal of the covenant promise that we make to love and to serve the person that we believe God brought together for us. It creates all kinds of pain and insecurity, and it ripples from generation to generation. And if you don't believe me, I'd love to have you come in and sit in some of my premarital counseling sessions where these young couples wrestle with their family of origin issues. More subtly, adultery not only robs others of their ability to flourish, but we're essentially robbing ourselves at the same time. It's a form of self-imposed slavery. We think that we're exercising the ultimate in freedom. We think that we're making choices that allow us to be all that we want to be, but in a sense, we're just creating a prison out of our own lies, out of our regrets, out of our guilt. And I guess I would add that, as we all know, this is not just about sex. There's many different ways that we can cheat on a spouse or on our family. Many different ways that we can break a covenant promise to love and to cherish and to value, whether that be the scourge of pornography, whether that be the subtle power of an emotional affair, a friendship that never leads to sex, but at the very minimum robs our spouse of the intimacy and our best selves that they deserve and not someone else. We certainly know that we can cheat on our spouses through our work, our sports, even our hobbies. Adultery is a disaster. Now, I know that I'm not sharing anything that you don't already know. But I guess the question that I would raise is, knowing these things, why do people choose this path? And here's where it's interesting. Here's where Jesus takes a look at this and kind of recasts the conversation. Right? It's easy, I think, too easy, to blame what we might describe as an over-sexualized culture. It's easy to blame all of the messages that we are bombarded with that reinforce our desire to be us, to experience freedom, to see sexuality as the ultimate expression of our identity and our need to be who we want to be. But Jesus turns it, and he puts his finger on it, and he did it 2,000 years ago. He said, look, adultery at the end of the day is not really about sex. It's not really about freedom or romance or adventure. Jesus says it's actually reflects the state of our hearts. Could be a King David who practiced adultery as a way of demonstrating power and entitlement. It could be the feeling that we are unfulfilled sexually at home, that we're bored with the tedium of a long-term relationship, that we're lonely or longing for communion with our spouse in life. But what Jesus is saying is that the adultery doesn't begin with the appeal of another person. The adultery begins with the brokenness in our own hearts. And it's that brokenness, then, that allows us to make the choice, right? To say that we are lonely enough, to say that we are hurting enough, to see that we are broken enough to make a conscious choice to betray a covenant promise that we have made to others, and in many cases, to God. So where might that leave us today? I'd like to share four thoughts with you that I pray are said and received in both grace and truth. The first thought is this, and I'm going to be very direct. Friends, if you're in an adulterous relationship, maybe this is the day that you take a step to get out. That it's the day that you recognize that this is not a lifestyle that honors God. That this is not a lifestyle that honors the spouse that you believe that God gave to you. That this is not seeking the best for anyone other than yourself and your own attempts to justify the choices that you're making. If you truly desire to have peace with God, if you truly desire to seek the abundant life as God defines it, then we have to stop living by our own definitions of what abundance looks like. And I hope I'm saying that not from a position of judgmentalism. I hope this is coming across as a desire to help, that we want to be here for you if you're in that place. We want to be your church and walk alongside you as I and others have walked along, many others who have come to realize this is not how they want to live their lives. It begins with confession, a willingness to be honest with God, a willingness to repent and to ask God for his grace, and the grace then to be able to seek forgiveness from those that we have hurt and to do the hard work to make things right. And I don't want to just leave it with a hard word that says, get out of it. I want to leave you with the word that says, we are here to help if we can be an assistance to you. Second word that I want to share is for those who might be victims of adultery, whether directly or indirectly, whether that is a present challenge in your life or whether that is something in your past that you are attempting to overcome, I pray that you will seek healing, that you will not just keep it to yourself, but that you would again know that we are here for you, whether it's we as your pastoral staff or the referrals that we can send out to you. We want to help all of our people heal and become whole in the grace of Jesus Christ. Friends, if your marriage is struggling in the midst of all of these pandemic trials, seek help. Marriage is hard. Even the best marriages are hard. I know of very few marriages that I would consider great marriages like my own that didn't benefit from, at some point, from a professional counselor or pastoral counseling or mentoring or some combination of all three. If you are hurting and struggling, I pray that this might be the day that you say, enough, I'm going to seek help. Thirdly, this is a word for all of us. I believe we all need to somehow find a way to learn. Maybe the church can provide more instruction on this, but we need to learn more about, trust more, and be governed by a deeper theological understanding than we are seeing in the world today. We need to have a theologically informed view of marriage, whether we're married or single, whether we're young or old, whether we're thinking about getting married or maybe never will get married again or at all. We need to have an understanding of what marriage theologically actually is. Practically, we need to recognize that, frankly, we all have a stake in healthy marriages. Whether we are married ourselves or not, we all have a stake in this church and in our larger community in healthy children and healthy families. I think we need to have a more mature understanding of what love actually is from a biblical standpoint. Will Willimon and Stanley Hauerwas have written a very profound and powerful commentary on the Ten Commandments. I love this quote from their chapter on not committing adultery. It says, "We believe that love is the fruit of marriage, the result of our faithful commitment to one another, rather than its cause. The question should not be, do you love? It's, will you love?" They go on to say, "Love is not a feeling, but a commitment, a promise, a gift one makes to God and to another person in gratitude for the gifts given to us by God and by others." Finally, I just love to invite you to wrestle with us not unlike the things that we talk about in our premarital counseling sessions, that what an amazing thing it would be if we all were able to have a discussion together about what a covenant promise actually is, as opposed to a transactional promise. You've heard me talk about this before, that a transactional promise essentially says, I will love you if. A covenant promise says, I will love you even if. I will love you even when the cost of loving you becomes higher than I expected it to be. It's understanding that living into a covenant promise takes a lot of work, a lot of work, and a lot of grace. And the things that hold it together are biblical principles of mutual submission, seeking to outdo one another in serving each other and showing each other honor. It requires self-sacrifice and self-denial, not self-fulfillment. As we learn what it means biblically to be stewards of each other's hearts. Finally, the last word that I want to share this morning is to go back to this essential question, which I think is the point of our entire study of the Ten Commandments, which is, if adultery is really reflective of the state of our hearts, who is ruling yours? We love to quote the parable, if you will, or the proverb that says, you know, there's more grace in God than there is sin in us, and that is true. It is so true that there is more grace in God than there will ever be sin in us. But friends, the way we receive that grace is not by presuming upon it, but by seeking it, by asking for it, by being willing to be honest with ourselves about the choices that we're making and honest with God, who knows all things anyway, and willing to claim the promise. Friends, willing to claim the promise that the one who knows your heart best is the one who is best equipped to heal it. So I want to leave with a word of hope. That even though this is a tough subject, we can approach it as followers of Jesus Christ with great hope, knowing that healing and even transformation is available to all. And particularly available to you if you find yourself in that place today. All we need to do to receive the grace of God, to receive the healing of God, to begin a path of transformation, all we need to do is ask. In Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. I invite you to think about these things for several minutes to reflect upon what God may or may not be saying to you in this time together, and then we'll invite John to come up and lead us in prayer and in the celebration of the Lord's Supper. God bless you.
So now we respond to God's word being preached with prayer and communion, and I just invite you now, let's pray. God, we take a deep breath after a sermon with such a topic, and we respond now with prayer, knowing that we are full of sorrow and joy. Sorrow in our sin in the way in which we have responded to your will and to your law in ways that are sinful and wrong. And so we have sorrow in our hearts, Lord, for those who have committed adultery, for those spouses who have been a part of that adultery, to those who are engaged in sexual addiction like pornography, for those who have issues in their own sexual identity that are unclear, to our society that is so sexualized. There are so many ways in which this topic and this sermon bring about sorrow in us. And we grieve for those who have been affected by this topic. We also, Lord, respond with joy. As our pastor said, we can have hope. We can hear your words of forgiveness and freedom. We can come to know that even those who have committed adultery can be your children if they want to be. That your grace actually extends to them and to all. So in our sorrow and joy, Lord, we pray that you would wrap us up in your loving arms, that you would remind us that you are very near when we grieve and mourn. We even think of those who are sick in our congregation, those who have lost loved ones, those who are waiting for a memorial service to say goodbye. We pray that you would be God over every aspect of all that we are and do as your people. So it's with sorrow and joy that we continue on in our worship, where as we enter into a time of communion, we would see both death and resurrection. So thank you, God, for all that you are and all that you do for us. We pray this in the name of Jesus, our Lord, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we come to the table this morning, please know that this is a confrontation with grace. It seems to be an oxymoron to use those two words together, a confrontation with grace, but that's exactly what it is. For those who say to themselves, I'm really not that bad, you are confronted with the need for God's grace, that you need it. For those who say to themselves, I could never be good enough, you are confronted with the need for God's grace, that God calls you his child. He welcomes you to this table. Communion is for you. So would you receive again today the grace of Jesus, that he has set the table for you and for me? And because of that grace, as we think about this table, that we would become a people who want to invite others, that we would share this good news with everyone that we know. And so we remember now, on the night Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it, saying, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And after supper, he took the cup and he said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. Drink of it, all of you. And so now, whenever we eat this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. If you haven't already, please go collect your elements in your kitchen to be able to serve either to yourself or to those who you are with. We recognize that we are still apart in so many ways, and yet as we enjoy this meal, we do so together. This is a meal that God has instituted for his church, wherever they are. And so please enjoy as we continue to worship the Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
Friends, as we conclude our time together this morning, I want to remind you to stay after the service for our Zoom chat. Some people have begun to refer to it as a virtual Palm Court, an opportunity to meet new people if you're new to the First Pres family, to ask questions about the sermon, or to just simply share what you heard God saying to you via the music or the prayers or the opening of His Word. So that will take place pretty much right after the service, and we invite you to stay and be a part of that. More and more people each week are telling us how much they enjoy the opportunity to be connected to one another in that capacity. I also want to say that it's not too late to sign up to participate in our church-wide conversation, Growing in Times of Exile. The opportunity to listen to a video by a master teacher, Jim Singleton, and to reflect in a small group or even just on your own about how the people of God, over the history of the people of God, have coped with dislocation, disappointment, and trial in their lives. I guarantee you that it will be well worth your time, and it will be a benefit to our church family and community to have you participate. You can find out more information about that on our website. And now, as we go out into the world, may we truly appropriate the promise that the one who knows your heart the best is the best equipped to heal it. Let us go out in hope, and let us share that hope with the world. In Jesus' name and for His sake, amen.
Thank you.